Well, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the East Orlando Chamber of Commerce, another virtual webinar that we have for you today. Once again, we have Will Perry, who's the CEO and CMO of Reason Agency, and he is discussing how to write copy that sells. So we're very excited to have him here today. Once again, some very informative and great information that he's provided, and we're very blessed and privileged to have him on board. I do want to make a couple announcements today. We are powered by PowerNet. And Mo, I think you're on the call today, but I'll just connect you with there. Mo Hussein or Mohammed Hussein is our rep from PowerNet. PowerNet is powering all of our webinars for the East Orlando Chamber, but they also do more than just meeting platforms. They also do IT work. They also do phone services and any piece when it comes to your technology needs. So we want to say thank you to PowerNet for powering our webinars. Also, want to recognize our trustees. These are stakeholders within our community. We have Advent Health, Avalon Park Group, Avalon Insurance Services, Duke Energy, Fairwinds Credit Union, Great Florida Insurance of Hunters Creek, the Orlando Law Group, Orlando Health, and Suburban Land Reserve. So we thank all of our trustees or stakeholders here in the community and great members, as all of our members, but with the East Orlando Chamber of Commerce and what they do to help us. I want to bring on also, while I've got everybody here, tomorrow at 11:30, we've got our Victory Gardens, Americans Pandemic Gardens and Creating Your Own. We have Tia Savalsi from UF who will be presenting that. So if you're looking for some interesting things to do while you may not be spending as much time out at places and things like that, that you can get connected with our Victory Gardens and how you can do that at your home. Also, moving up, our Healthcare Collaborative Council is a peer-to-peer virtual referral forum on August 6th. That's Thursday at 8 a.m. to 9 a.m., once again, powered by PowerNet, but we will be doing referrals between doctors and the referral agents and for our private practitioners that are here and independent practitioners that are here in East Orange County. Also, plan your calendar for Wednesday, August 19th at 12 o'clock. We have UCF president, the brand new president for UCF, Dr. Alexander Cartwright, will be speaking for our luncheon topic on the 19th of August. So please plan that and put that on your calendar. That should be a great informative piece. And then letting you know, Coffee Club is going virtual. We're having Coffee Club Nona August 20th from 8:30 to 9:30. We've got some great things planned for that so that you can get networked and connected in back with our members. So we are back with that. Come join us. We've got a neat program planned and some great things we're going to implement forward so that you can get your networking pieces all done. And then Optic this month is on August 21st from 10:30 to 12. We are doing social media when it is too social, social media security and impact on your business. Ian Meyer is putting this on. This is a phenomenal program we have for that, especially with a lot of the outbreaks and pieces we're hearing from TikTok, which a lot of people have used and putting out there. So this is an extremely informative piece there. And that's all I've got. So without further ado, I'm going to bring on our featured speaker, Will Perry, today. So Will, without further ado, take it away and welcome back to the East Orlando Chamber's virtual webinars.
Thank you so much. Hopefully this event is as delightful as all of those other ones sound. So very good. If you guys have tuned in over the last couple of weeks, this is the third part in a three-part series. Part one, we talked about what it takes to thrive online and what thriving brands are doing to succeed. Last, 2 weeks ago's topic was how to create irresistible offers. And today we're gonna chat about how to write copy that sells. So for anyone who hasn't joined on any of the previous ones, just wanna kind of give some context, you know, into this and kind of bring it all together, essentially. So I would definitely recommend that you check out those two prior videos. I think the Chamber has them on their YouTube page. I've also posted them on my YouTube page as well. So I would definitely recommend that you check those out. And then if you guys know me a little bit by this point, my style tends to be a little bit direct. And so my goal here is really helping you guys really cut through all the noise and all the crap, honestly, so that we can get down into what works, and taking action steps into really helping you succeed online with all of your marketing and all of your businesses. So today we're going to touch on how to write copy that sells, that gets more people taking action. So let me just, okay, perfect. So that, Andrew, that's coming through, right? Everything's working properly. Okay, cool. Just wanted to make sure. So for anyone who is new, who the heck am I? My name is Will Perry. I am the CEO and CMO of Reason. I'm a digital marketer through and through. It runs in my blood and through my veins. I wake up in the morning thinking about ads and ad copy and copywriting and concepts. And I love selling. I love helping people figure out a sales process that helps them really grow their businesses. It's what I think about almost every hour of every day, sometimes to my own detriment. So I hope to really share a lot of what I've learned over the last decade plus here with you guys. And so what we're going to cover specifically today, kind of starting at 30,000 feet, and then we'll work into the trenches here, is, you know, why your marketing, quote unquote, isn't working. I mean, I hear this. This is probably one of the things that I hear the most, you know, whether it's on a call or, you know, questions, you know, we'll do a Q&A at the end. I'm sure you guys have said this before, that my marketing isn't working. What the difference is between a push and a pull strategy. And then ultimately, we're going to get into copy that converts with a 7-step process. And we're going to touch on the formula. So who this is for. So if you are the marketing manager, the marketing director, the CEO, the CMO, or if you're getting ready to start an online business, you guys are in the right spot. This information is completely tailored to you so that you can put action steps in place. Like, we're going to get right into how exactly to do this and the process that I've created over the years, and exactly how I write copy that converts. So, you know, why listen to me? The strategies that I'm sharing with you today have helped me generate more than $13 million in sales in multiple businesses. So I know that it works. And when you follow the steps and the principles and the strategies, they've been proven time and time and time again to drive sales. And that's why we're all here, so that we can drive revenue into our businesses and we can develop marketing that converts and drives sales. And here's just a few of the brands that we've helped. And that's enough basically about me at this point. So if you guys remember, something that I've shared with you over the last two presentations is this concept that if the message is bad, the marketing will fail. And I'm going to keep beating it into y'all's heads. So I want you to really think about this concept. Take notes, like take a screenshot, whatever you've got to do. Please trust me that if your marketing is not working, it's because the message sucks. Like, the message is bad. And what does it mean to be bad? So that's a very subjective sort of term, right? Or analysis. So we'll go through that and how to really dig into that. You know, this quote by Ryan Dice is something that has stuck with me for years. Someone that, you know, I should mention it, digitalmarketer.com, they have all sorts of online trainings with this sort of stuff that are extremely affordable, you know, $50, $100, $500, you know, things like that. So if there's specific topics that you want to learn more about, I'd highly recommend that you check that out. I've trained a lot of my team using their online trainings, and it's a really helpful and affordable resource. So definitely check that out. So I want to touch on what this difference is of push and pull. You know, if you could, like, in the chat, if this sounds familiar to you guys, just, you know, throw a little heads up, throw a little yes or a no. I want to get a sense for, like, as we're going through this next little section, how many of you are familiar, you know, with this term of what push marketing is and what pull marketing is. So, I can understand that, you know, a lot of us, we look at the Fortune 500 companies for inspiration, whether it's, you know, Home Depot, Starbucks, Coca-Cola, UPS, Walmart, Best Buy. You know, we look at these big brands that are all recognizable to us, and we try to learn from them. You know, we try to take inspiration from them. We try to learn about their products, how they're positioning their service, some of the messaging maybe that they're using, what their website looks like, how they've developed the product, all of these things. But the problem is, you guys are not Apple, right? We are not Apple. And if I had like literally a nickel for every time that someone told me, well, Apple does this, or Apple's brand is super clean, and their website this, and their product that, and their message and all the things, like, it sometimes it actually makes me almost want to vomit because of the amount of comparisons that we all draw towards a brand like Apple. But I want us to stop trying to market like the big companies. This is what is called a push strategy, and they have huge freaking budgets, billions of dollars that us as small and medium-sized business owners do not have. So the definition of a push strategy is essentially pushing your agenda, your message, onto your customer, no matter what it takes. And it could be things like, oh, we have the best XYZ service because of this, or, you know, we think, you know, any sort of Coca-Cola message that you guys have seen throughout the years where they're, you know, they're pushing the Christmas campaigns and the, the summer campaigns, you know, the freshness of how the beverage tastes and things like that. But they have massive marketing budgets to be able to continue to get that message in front of you. So what does that mean? It means high frequency, high frequency. I keep seeing it. I keep seeing it. I keep seeing it. And ultimately, that's what drives the repetition into your mind. And that's what really brings that recall, is that high repetition. But like I said, the problem is, we don't have the budget in order to do that. So I want us to start marketing based on what our customer needs. And that is more of a pull strategy. And this is what drives conversion. When we understand what our customer wants, what their desires are, what their problems are, what their pain points are, et cetera, we're able to lead them through a user journey and through a process that ultimately drives conversion. And conversion means sales, and sales means that we grow our businesses and we grow our revenue. And so that is the main difference between a push strategy and a pull strategy. Brand awareness is a push strategy. And just honestly, like, this is a waste of your time and your money, because there's not a call to action. It's not really putting a lot of value in terms of what this can do for me, in terms of, generating action into your sales process. Remember, all of this is about how do we get people into our sales process? And so brand awareness is like these light touches. And remember, if we're marketing like Apple, we don't have big budgets. So that means that people need to see our brand 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 times. So think of the amount of frequency that you would need to be able to generate in order to create this push strategy. You know, whether you're a law firm or an IT company, or whether you're selling coffee online, if you're just trying to put your brand in front of someone, it's not really generating a whole lot of action. And it's going to take a massive amount of repetition before they're really going to recall and do something about it. So I want us to consider more of a direct response strategy. This is a pull strategy, and it's based on what your customer wants and desires. And that's what this entire presentation is about. It's about, how do we create a marketing message that isn't bad, that is based on our customers' wants and desires? Because this is ultimately the key as to why anyone's marketing is not working. Whether it's an ad, an email, a billboard, a text campaign, a flyer, et cetera, is because the messaging has not been based on what the customer wants and what they desire. So we're going to go through that exact process, lead you through a couple of examples and step by steps in order to implement this, you know, honestly, within the next few days or 30 days into your, whatever it is that you're marketing. All of these principles can be applied to any service, any business, like I said, an email, a presentation, an ad, a landing page, et cetera. So the reason that your marketing hasn't been working is because you didn't know the formula. And that's exactly what I'm going to show you today. So I hope that you guys appreciate, you know, this meme, because I'm a big meme guy. And if you think about, you know, all of this whole process that we've talked about already, the push, the pull, understanding what our customer wants and what they desire and the messages that we're putting out there, this is the key and the difference between driving copy that converts and creating marketing messages that don't really end up leading to a whole lot of anything. So, and if you remember as well, something that I've touched on over the last couple of weeks is, if you haven't helped your dream customer establish a new belief, they will not buy. The entire sales process, the marketing process, your marketing messages should be geared towards helping your customer establish a new belief. Because when we have a new belief, we are hopeful. And when we are hopeful, we take action, right? So that's why the formula is so important. I'm going to share the formula with you guys today, and hopefully you're a little bit hopeful on exactly what you need to do and the steps that you need to start taking in order to start developing marketing that drives sales and drives conversion. Whether you're looking for leads or whether you're looking to drive revenue through your website, this is the key to all of it. So this is the exact seven-step process. Take a screenshot, write your notes, do whatever you have to do. We're going to go through all of this in detail. So the copy that converts seven-step process is this. Step one, I want you guys to read the Amazon reviews. We're going to go through this in detail. Step two, actually, why don't we just kind of check this out? We'll go through each step. So step one is going through and reading all of your competitor Amazon reviews. This is also including Facebook reviews, Google reviews, et cetera. So I want you to especially read the 1, 2, and 3-star reviews. I want you to pay special attention to what people are saying, what are their objections, what do they like, what do they not like. Something that could really help you here is, you know, if you're using Google Drive, for example, screenshot all of these reviews. Like, create an entire folder where you can go screenshot all of these reviews and put them all into a folder based on these four questions. What are people saying? What are their objections to the product? You know, what do they like? What do they not like? So let's say that you're selling, because one of the ones that I remember is Connie, who is selling CBD products online. So let's say that Connie goes to Amazon and she looks at ABC CBD company, and you know, there's 100 reviews about their CBD oil, and you know, people are literally telling her what exactly they do not like about her competitor's product. Either it's too expensive, it tastes bad, it doesn't work, it's not a strong enough formula, they wish that it came in a bigger bottle. So you're literally getting all of this direct feedback as to what people like and what they don't like. So I want you to take notes on this. I want you to take screenshots and, you know, compile all of those notes into a document or a spreadsheet, because this is really going to be your ammunition later on as we kind of start to build this process. Because what you want to understand is, you want to understand how your dream customer is reacting in this market. You know, like I said, what are they saying and what are their objections as to why they are not buying? And if you can understand their objections, you can literally overcome their objections throughout your marketing messaging, whether it's an ad, an email, et cetera, your website, and you can overcome those objections to turn visitors into buyers. So that's step one. Step two is, I want you to write down the 10 pain points your customer has. What do they struggle with? What problems do they have? What solutions have they tried? Let's stick with the example of CBD because it's a really easy example. So maybe I struggle with back pain, or maybe I have knee pain or ankle pain or chronic pain. So these are all different things and pain points that I have. Maybe I've tried ABC, you know, product before, or I've tried some of these other competitors, or I've tried, you know, there's so many different ways that you can consume CBD. Like maybe I've tried topical solutions, which means applying it to the skin. Maybe I've tried, I think there's also like, you can try it in pill form. You can try it like, sometimes it comes in like a chew or a gum or something like that. So maybe you've tried all these other solutions and none of them have worked. So literally in your copy, you would say something like, hey, have you tried the gum, the chews, the creams, have you tried all these solutions and still you haven't achieved your desired result? So I want you to write down at least 10. And if you can't think of 10, I want you to challenge yourself to think of 10. And if you're struggling to get 10, go back to the Amazon reviews and write down what people are already saying. The secret is in the reviews. You already know what the pain points are by doing the research. Through the research, you will find out what people's pain points are. So that's step two. And so here's an example. So getting into some practicality of what are some of the pain points that my dream customer has? I run an ad agency that helps online businesses scale online. And some of the pain points that my customers have are that their return on the ad spend is too low, that their ads aren't working, that their website has a high bounce rate, that they spend a lot of time or they've spent a lot on ads with little to no conversions. They don't know how to scale online and they feel like they've tried everything. So these are just a few of some of the probably hundreds of different pain points that my customer has. And then being able to overcome those objections through my marketing is how I will be able to turn them into a prospect. So step three is what I call the 10 objections outline. So there are 10 questions that most often people ask themselves subconsciously when they're observing your brand. Again, whether it's an ad, your website, an email, these are things that they're asking themselves subconsciously as they're reading your marketing materials. So there's 10 questions, and I want to challenge you guys to put 10 responses for every one of these 10. So by the time you're done with this exercise, I want you to actually have 100. If you're struggling to get 100, go back to step one, read the reviews, go back to step two, and continue to go through this exercise until you have 10 for every question. So question number one is, how is your product different from everything else that your customer has seen? And ultimately, if you struggle to answer this question, it is probably the number one fundamental reason as to why we're struggling to turn visitors into sales, or turn ads into sales, or turn emails into leads or sales, is because people are not understanding what is making you different. And so if your message doesn't say, hey, this is what makes us different from everyone else, you don't have to be that elementary or clear cut and dry, but your message does need to speak to what makes your product and your service different. So I want you to list out 10 specific things that makes your product different and what makes it stand out differently from your competition. Number two is, what's in it for me and what will I get out of it? So this is all of the benefits. So I want you to list 10 benefits that your product has, you know, for your dream customer. Number three, how do I know this product is real? So this is where you can speak to things like case studies. You can speak to reviews like, hey, we have a 4.7 star review rating on Amazon with more than 1,000 reviews. And we have all of these testimonials that can speak to how people know that this is a real thing, whether it's from a product or a service perspective. I want you to list 10 different ways that you can come up with that would demonstrate that people can trust that this is a real solution. Number four is, what has held me back in the past from getting the results I want? So let's go back to the CBD example. Is, you know, for example, maybe I've only taken CBD in pill form. Well, it's a fact that I think it's something like, I don't know the exact stats, maybe less than 20% of what we consume in pill form actually gets absorbed into the blood, but 96% of what we consume through liquids actually absorbs into the blood 3 to 5 times faster. Random stat that I know just from years of research of other things. So when we overcome that objection and we list out exactly all of the things that has probably held people back, let's speak to this presentation specifically. What has held you guys back in the past is you didn't know the difference between a push and a pull strategy. You didn't know that it wasn't smart. I shouldn't say smart because that sounds condescending, so I apologize. You didn't know that it was best practice to lean more of on a pull strategy than a push strategy and going more with direct response instead of brand awareness. And you didn't know there was a formula for this stuff. You didn't know that your message should be all 100% focused on overcoming your customers' objections, and it should be based on their wants and desires, not about you. So think of it like that dating example that we talked about in presentation number one. You know, many of us have been on first dates, whether we're married now or in a relationship or et cetera. But can you imagine going on a date with someone where all they do is talk about themselves? Like, what is it, you know, 5-10 minutes, like you're tuning it out, right? You lose interest, and it's just like very self-centered. It's a huge turnoff. And a lot of us are marketing this way. We're marketing about what makes us so great, and we're not engaging our dream customer into the conversation based on their wants and desires and showing interest in them. So that's how we want to be talking about, you know, what has held me back in the past. So I want you to list 10. Like, what are 10 reasons why I haven't gotten the results that I've wanted? Number 5, who or what is to blame for my past lack of results? This is very similar to number 4. So speaking again to this this idea of not knowing the formula. So you guys didn't know the formula for writing copy, so how could you write good copy? Well, you probably wouldn't unless you've come from a marketing background, or you're a very talented copywriter, or, you know, something of that nature. So the fact is, you guys just didn't know the formula. You didn't know the steps. You didn't know the tricks, the cheat codes, the shortcuts, all the things in order to write copy that converts. Number 6, why should I do this now? Same principle here. I want us to write 10 reasons why I should do this now. Well, the number one, probably most important reason why you should learn how to write copy that converts right now is that it's costing you a significant amount of time and money in your business. You're putting all of these marketing messages out there that are taking a lot of time to create or costing a lot of money that aren't developing any sort of conversion or driving sales. So that's the exact reason why you need to implement this process now, because it's costing you a significant amount of time and money. So I want you to list out 10 other reasons as to why I should do this now. Maybe it's a limited time offer and it expires at the end of the month, or maybe you only have 500 units in stock and it's a special limited edition product. This is why you should buy this product right now. Number 7, why should I trust you? So this is kind of similar to the number 3 with why, how do I know this product is real? So do you have a patent? Do you have scientific research, you know, to back this up? Have you been voted the number one pizza in Orlando? You know, like, that establishes trust as to why, you know, I can trust that this is a good product, for example. Just trying to throw random stuff at you guys so you can see, you know, when we really start to get into writing these responses and then using it as ammunition for our marketing message, we can overcome these subconscious objections that people have as to why they take action. Number 8, how does your product work? So just pretty straightforward. What are the steps? Step 1, step 2, step 3, how exactly does it work? What are the parts? What are the pieces? What do I need to know in terms of how this solution will help me achieve my desired result? So let's say that it's a workout program, and, you know, let's say it's the P90X example, which I think I used a few weeks ago. Is the P90X workout program is an online program that is essentially a 90-day program where there's a new workout every day. So there's a new workout every day that's based on this concept called muscle confusion. You follow that step-by-step process for 3 weeks, and then you transition into a new phase. So basically, this workout program will, let's say that you want to get in better shape, lose 5 pounds, whatever, you're just all around feel healthier. Like, explaining how that process works will give people who are logical and need detail the information that they need in order to make that decision. Number 9, how can I get started? This is pretty straightforward. You can get started by setting up a discovery call, by booking a free consultation, by shop now or order now or any of those things. So this is your call to action. At this point, you've started to build your argument, as to why your product or service is the solution that they need. And, lastly, this is ultimately the final push that they would need in order to basically take action. And what do I have to lose? So there's a lot of different ways that you could position, what do I have to lose? Let's say it's a free trial. What do I have to lose? Well, I have nothing to lose. It's a free trial. It's a 7-day trial, a 14-day trial, a 30-day trial. Why the heck not, test this product out or test this service out for 30 days, with a money back guarantee, 100% money back guarantee, no questions asked. So again, other messages that can be used on your website, in your email, on your ads, et cetera, that would overcome that objection of what do I have to lose. Number 9 and number 10 are probably going to be a little bit harder to list out 10, but I still want you guys to try to challenge yourselves to come up with 10. So that's step 3. Step 4 is I want you to write 10 hooks. So a hook is ultimately what gets someone's attention. It's like one very powerful line of copy that either, like I said, grabs their attention or piques their curiosity or asks them a question based on their pain or challenges their beliefs. So here were 3 that I just made up for today. So piquing curiosity, an example would be, have you read Copy That Converts, a simple 7-step process that gets prospects taking action? I made that up. That's not actually real. ask a question based on pain. Struggling to write ad copy that sells? So you're automatically like getting your dream customer to say, hey, yeah, that's a problem that I have. And so everything that you would basically say to them afterwards is based on this pain point that you already know that they have because they've taken interest in this question. Or challenge a belief, like a really bold statement. The days of putting 10% of revenue towards marketing are long gone. We are probably all familiar with the idea that you should, reserve 10% of revenue towards marketing in order to be able to grow. But most often, what's actually very surprising is, this goes back to our presentation from week one, was 40% of revenue of the fastest growing online businesses is going towards digital advertising and marketing. So they're literally fueling their companies faster through their marketing and their marketing dollars. And this is really intended to challenge y'all's belief on investing and spending in marketing. The reason why you have probably felt that your marketing wasn't working is because we've probably been putting out some generic sales messages and writing some generic flyers and writing some generic ads and some generic emails that don't follow this step-by-step process that pull people in, hook them based on their curiosity, and ultimately provide a solution that really helps them achieve their desired result, not the desired result that you want them to have. So I want you to write 10 hooks similar to these 3 that I've written here, and try to, write a few that might pique your customer's curiosity, that ask questions based on the pain points. We wrote those out in step 2. And then challenges their beliefs. So think about current beliefs that your current customer has, and, you know, write those out, these bold statements that people believe to be true. But if, remember, if you can help someone establish a new belief, then they will start to take action. So those are three types of different hooks that you could write. And a hook would be something like an email subject line that you could use. It would be the first line of ad copy on a Facebook ad. It would be the name of the presentation for, like today, for example. It could be the first line of copy on a blog or a landing page, a headline on a landing page. Again, all geared towards the pain point and the solution that you provide that speaks to your customers' desired result that they have. So that's step four. So step five is then crafting a story. And the way to craft a story is just so much simpler when you can pull this information from the 10 objections outline that we filled out in one of the prior steps. So now you understand what the objections are about the product. You understand what people want, what they desire. You understand their pain points. You understand the solutions that they've tried before. You understand, you know, what has held them back and what has kept them from taking action. So now you've got all this ammunition. You've got this, all of this understanding of your dream customer, and it makes it so much easier to write copy because it makes them feel like you understand them. So here's an example of a story that was part of an ad campaign that we ran, I don't know, maybe like 6 months ago. So the hook was this. Remember when you first launched your ads, you were already halfway to Tahiti, ready to drink away the profits you were about to make, thinking about all the time ahead with family and the trips around the world, the freedom. This is America after all. If you're not doing it for the freedom, you might as well get the, okay, too much. Here's how most e-commerce brands and online businesses try to scale. Ready? So what I did was is I kind of created this word picture, right, of the things that I have thought as an entrepreneur. I mean, how many of you guys are like, man, I'm just going to launch this online business. It's going to be so freaking great. Like, this is what my team's going to look like. This is what our projected revenue is going to be in 2020. And man, I'm going to be able to finally spend so much time with my family and all the things. And like, then it doesn't happen. And then, you know, we all go into this big giant like craze of it not working out, and we're stressed and we're frustrated and all the things. But what I did was I demonstrated understanding of my dream customer. Like, I know what they're going through. Another good way of maybe trying to relate it back to you guys is relating your ad copy, your email copy, your landing page copy back to use cases or situations that your customer is in. You know, so in this case, this speaks to the online business owner, right? This is something that they can relate to. But I pulled all of that information from my 10 objections outline. You know, their desires, they want to travel more. They want freedom. You know, they wanted to be able to spend more time with family. So different things there that I pulled in where they're like, yes, 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 of course I want that, right? So that's one example. We'll go through another ad example that's more product related as well. So step five is crafting a story. And this would be an example that, you know, you could write in an email, like if you're doing cold emailing, you know, to generate leads for your service-based business, or if you are need ads in order to market a product online. This is an example of a story structure that you could use that basically describes a situation that your customer is going through. So number six is going to be positioning the offer. So we first started by hooking our user in based on their pain point, something that they wanted. Then we showed understanding and of what they're going through, and we shared a story that related very much to them. Now we're going to position the offer. So if we're writing an ad or an email or a presentation, we're hooking them in, we're helping them establish a new belief, and then we're like, hey, here's my solution. You know, at this point, if you have identified the customer's pain, hooked them in and demonstrated you have understanding of their likes, dislikes, what they've tried, what hasn't worked, and start to show them a better way, they will take action, which is exactly what we're doing here today. I've demonstrated understanding for what you've tried, what you haven't tried, some of the examples that you've pulled from, and now I'm showing you a better way so that you can take action to write copy that converts. So if you want even more information on how to create irresistible offers that drive sales faster, I want you to check out the YouTube video that the Chamber and myself have online. I'm pretty sure that's actually titled How to Create Irresistible Offers. You can get even more information there on how to turn your product into an offer, because your product is not an offer. It's all of the other things that go into it. Your sales message, the solution that it provides, the financial terms that it provides, as well as some other very key things that ultimately make it a no-brainer for your dream customer to take you up on your offer. So that's step six. And step seven is putting it all together. So this is actually the formula. What I didn't tell you guys in the beginning is that the formula is hook, story, offer. Or another way to put it is the formula is problem, agitate, solve. And in an even more literal fashion, from top to bottom, it is hook, story, offer, problem, agitate, solve. So pain point, question, story that demonstrates understanding, offer after you've demonstrated understanding of the product. So here's an example of an ad campaign that we're running for a client. It's a long story short, it's basically like an electrolyte powder that you can put into water. So what I've done is I've literally broken down the structure and the framework of this ad copy, because you know you can only see just the first line, which is the hook. So the hook is, drinking water isn't enough and popular hydration drinks don't cut it. This is that example of challenging a belief, right? So we're all told like, oh, hey, like you have to drink, 8 ounce glasses of water a day. But the problem is that when you sweat, you're losing upwards of 15 vitamins when you sweat. So now this story goes into demonstrating understanding and agitating that problem. So the copy reads, the problem is popular hydration formulas, we won't name names, i.e. like Gatorade or Propel or all the things, fall short of replenishing the body with what it needs and are loaded with sugar. So now we're piquing curiosity like, what does that mean? Well, introducing Hydrate, the world's first and only complete hydration formula, complete with all 15 vitamins and minerals lost through sweat during physical activity. So now we're challenging that belief. We're telling them a little bit of a story. This doesn't have to be hard in terms of telling them a story. It doesn't have to be as elaborate as the example with like my dream customer, for example, who they have so many objections and so much skepticism in that sort of industry versus on this side, the product. Like, it doesn't take as much convincing to overcome people's beliefs or to pique their curiosity. So then it's literally just describe a little bit of something about the product in 3 delicious, refreshing flavors, just 5 calories, 0 sugar. So the 5 calories and 0 sugar thing would go back to those objections that someone might have about the product, you know, from think of Amazon reviews. Well, this product has too much sugar or it's too high in calories. Overcome those objections through your copy. And then lastly, like literally the last 3 lines of the ad copy say, curious to give Hydrate a try? Get up to 45% off Hydrate today, plus free shaker with purchase. Get yours here. This ad is literally freaking crushing it. We're driving 7% conversion on this ad to people who've never seen this product before, which is 3 times the industry standard. The industry standard for selling products online is about 2%. So when we can demonstrate that we have an understanding for the end consumer's pain points, we can overcome their objections through the copy, and then we can position a solution. That's why people are buying this product so frequently. We actually sold this company out of inventory this month and they're about to put in another 50,000 unit purchase order because things are working so well. So when you understand this hook story offer formula, you can use it for an ad, you can use it for an email, you can use it for a landing page, you can use it for a website, you can use it for a presentation, and you can walk people through this journey. So let's use the example of today. Our hook for today was how to write copy that sells or converts. This is something that you guys want. It's your desired result. You want to learn how to write copy that converts, because I know so well that one of the problems that y'all have is that your marketing doesn't work, right? So the story that we told was, you've been marketing like Apple, doing it the wrong way, and you didn't know there was a formula, which is what was holding you back, right? So we've started to establish some new beliefs, and then I positioned this offer to you, this solution that was, hey, here's the 7-step process for writing copy that converts, and now hopefully you guys have a new belief. I've kind of kidded about this a couple of other times. Unfortunately, I don't have anything to sell you, and nor am I allowed, but we've now established a new belief here today that the 7-step process of copy that converts is the exact reason why your marketing isn't working. Because if you remember back to the beginning, if your message is bad, the marketing will fail. And this 3-step process is exactly what you can use, again, for a presentation, email subject lines, email body copy, Facebook ad copy, sales letters, or landing page copy. You can literally follow this formula from top to bottom in order to be able to pull people into your marketing instead of pushing your agenda that you want to push onto them. You can lure them in based on what their wants and desires are, and ultimately take marketing that drives conversion, that turns leads and prospects and visitors into sales, and ultimately helps make your marketing extremely more effective by being able to understand exactly how to, from a psychology standpoint, lead someone in and present a solution to them. So that's all I have for you guys today. That's the 7-step process and the formula to create copy that converts. I know I just threw a ton of stuff at you guys. I hope that you have questions. I'm going to stick around for the next 10 or 15 minutes to go through some of those questions. I hope that a lot of you guys are still with me and would love to even walk through some specific scenarios, even, you know, throw you guys some different copy ideas and things like that if you want it. So I'm all ears. You guys definitely let me know what you want to chat about next.
So I'm going to throw this one out there just to talk, but if you have, you don't have necessarily have a tangible product that you're selling, but you're selling a service for some of those that might, you know, or products or events that you're trying to promote, that like a piece. What are some pieces that you recommend on things like that?
Yeah, so let's use the chamber as an example, and then I'll go back to my service as an example. So like, so remember, it goes back to what do people want. The reason that people, most probably 8 or 9 times out of 10, based on what my understanding would be, why they join the chamber is their desire is to increase sales. And in order to increase sales, they know that they need to develop connections. You know, the purpose of the chamber should be to help other businesses grow their revenues. You know, so a lot of times where I have found the struggle with chambers and organizations, don't take any sort of offense to this, is like we get together in these events and like I've got stacks and stacks and stacks of business cards that I've collected from networking over the years. And you know what? It's 9 times out of 10 hasn't turned into a whole lot of anything, right? And that's when I really started learning, like when I launched my business about 5 years ago. Of like, how do I do something different? Like, how do I go to where people, where my dream customer is? And so from the chamber's perspective, how do we create messages that speak to the direct end result that our customer wants? Y'all's customer is business owners. So how do we help them achieve their desired result? These events, for example, are one way that we help them achieve their desired result, but it's still slightly disconnected because there's a lot of time and energy and effort that needs to be put into just understanding this one presentation that we've now spent an hour on, that someone would then need to go spend 5 to 10 more hours on just completing this exercise before they would ever even really be able to put that into action. In my world, in a service-based business, it's creating hooks based on the problems that my dream customer has. So, you know, to go back to slide, what was it? This one right here. So the pain points that my customers have when I'm on calls with them. So my sales process is first I provide a free consultation for everyone. So we have a discovery call, and we're basically, I'm trying to understand what more about their business. And most of the things that they tell me are that their ads aren't working, or that they're not getting enough conversions through their website, or they don't know how to scale their online in 3x or 5x their revenue. They feel like they've tried everything and their ads are not profitable enough. So when we're putting these messages out there, we're hooking people into our marketing based on the problems and solutions that they want and need. And then we ultimately create a process that helps them take advantage of that irresistible offer. The irresistible offer in my business is a free audit. So we literally give qualified prospects a $1,500 valued audit where we literally dissect all of their ad campaigns, Facebook, Google. We dissect their website, all of their Google Analytics. And then we literally create a 40-page presentation that tells them exactly what they need to do in order to fix it. And that's my irresistible offer. So I hook people in based on the fact that, any one of these problems, I have a discovery call with them. I have understanding of their business. I offer them a low risk offer in order to take the next step. Then we go through the audit review, which builds credibility and why they need to take action now. And then ultimately we position a service-based contract in order to basically take over their online advertising. That's literally my entire sales process, to a T.
So I two questions, one a follow-up on this one. One is, if you can't find reviews for potentially, some rep websites are not posting those, or you're not found on, and or don't hard to find the negative reviews. So you're having a hard time finding your customer base. What are other ways to look at that? And then Connie had put in there, what if you don't have any ads at all? How can you review that? So that's just another kind of piece. I wanted to make sure you're getting the question in the chat box.
So I see that one from Connie. So do a Google search. So, go look at the Google reviews. Go read articles as to the 10 reasons why, people don't like CBD, or the 10 reasons why people join a chamber, for example. So there's all these sort of listicles out there with regard to more information about why people are taking action or why they're not taking action. So with Connie, and feel free to unmute here so I can understand the question a little bit further. I think, so you said, what if you do not have ads at all? That could be reviewed, and I think you're referring to how do you know that if your offer will work or not work? Is that the question?
Talking about your offer.
My offer?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So can you elaborate?
Well, you just said what you offer is a $1,500 audit on all previous off ads that you've done. I have no ads.
Yeah. So the most direct response, Ani, and I love you because you've been here all three times, not a qualified prospect for me. Right. So it's okay. But that's why it goes back to understanding who is my dream customer. My dream customer is someone who's already spending $10,000 a month on ads. They've gone through the pain of what that process is like. They're not afraid to spend. They're willing to invest, et cetera. And so it took me a really long time to finally get clear on who my dream customer was and who they weren't. I had to be okay with saying no. I had to be okay with not selling to everyone in order to sell to the one person that I knew would help me grow my business. And that's people who are already spending money on ads. So just one example, in how like it relates specifically like in an advertising agency world.
Yeah, and I understand that. But the reason why I haven't done it is because I'm not allowed to do it.
Right.
I've been allowed to do it.
Yeah. So we're actually running ads for a CBD company right now, but it's in the dog industry, the pet space. So I would recommend that you go review the Google and Facebook ad policies, because you can market topical CBD, and you can also market topical and ingestible hemp. So what a lot of companies are doing is they are kind of marketing their product as hemp specifically, instead of marketing it specifically as CBD, which would allow your ads to pass ad policy.
But I was told in one of the other webinars that we had that you can do topicals, but you have to have nothing ingestible on your website.
Yeah, that's true.
Topicals.
Yeah, you can also develop landing pages with unique URLs. So let's just say that it's, what's the name of your company again?
Nona Oils.
Nona Oils. So let's say that you were to go create like ConniesHempOil.com, and like that, you are running ads direct to ConniesHempOil.com. Like that URL has no association whatsoever with NonaOils.com. And so it's what's called a product funnel. And it's basically this scenario of running ads directly to a landing page where it's disconnected from your website, because Facebook is and Google are crawling your website, right? Like they know that your pages say CBD all over them. So the minute that you go launch an ad, it crawls the site, it flags the ad, and then it shuts down the ad account. But if you strip all of that out, or if you develop landing pages where you're running traffic direct to the landing pages, there's no connection between the landing page and the website. So that's how you would be able to do that.
So do you need a, would she need a link between the landing page to her Nona Oils page? Is that what you would do in there? Or how does that work that she gets back to her main page?
Yeah, you would need a separate checkout process. So like you could use, for example, this is getting a little bit into the technical, but I want you to check out sticky.io. I'll put it here in the chat. Sticky.io does process high risk online transactions. It's basically like Shopify. Were you on Shopify, Connie, or were you using WordPress and WooCommerce?
I use WordPress, but I have a processor company that I use.
Yeah, no, I completely understand that.
Okay.
So what you could do potentially then is just route that landing page traffic directly into your checkout. So, you know, you would need to work with a digital marketer essentially who knows how to do that, how to create basically links from your landing page directly into checkout. But to what Andrew was saying, that's essentially what you would do.
Okay. That's helpful. Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I was thinking that.
Any other questions from anyone else?
So I do know, and I'll look for the chat box, and if you feel like it, you can unmute yourself if you have a question for Will. You know, because we have a lot of members, and we're trying, you know, they're trying to get out there, and especially now where they can't necessarily network with people left and right. Yeah. But, to be able to try to get their marketing push. So, you know, I'm looking at folks that were on the call that are in, you know, they're in insurance. Some of them are nonprofits that are here that may have a message they're trying to get out. So they may not necessarily be selling something, but it's really trying to find that hook. And I think you can, the book that you recommended, the 16 word, But anyway, where I was going with it is that you've got different pieces where people are looking for those driving traffic back. But if you can make the hook is what you're really looking to do, is to get people to come to you to answer the pain or to have an interest to go dig deeper of what you're offering.
Right, exactly. So one way that we could all do this in a virtual environment is we can leverage LinkedIn here for some cold outreach. So if we get our hooks in order, we can, and if we know who our dream customer is, so I'll stick on the example of our ad agency just because it's pretty easy to describe. And you could do the same thing in insurance or law or, well, maybe business law. Is like, so we now know that my dream customer is an online business owner who is probably generating more than $500,000 a year in online sales. And their number one pain point is that they don't know how to scale. So if I have my 10 hooks, I can go to LinkedIn and I can reach out to the marketing director, the CEO, the marketing manager, et cetera. And I can say, hey, not getting the return on ad spend that you're looking for. Check out this, grade your ads, check out this free audit here and send them a link. So those are some ways that you could use like a cold emailing strategy on LinkedIn and send your hooks to your dream customer. Like it's tedious and we've done it and I've done it. I've generated leads this way in the past. Fortunately for us, like we're not a volume based business. So like I can't take like 100 deals or 500 deals or what have you like into my sales process. But, you know, some of you who can, you know, do 100 deals a month or 500 deals a month who can do more volume, you know, you can send these hooks through LinkedIn based on your customers' wants and desires. And, you know, offer a free consultation, offer a free strategy call, you know, offer an ebook, offer something to them that gets them taking action. And you'll start to generate some leads that way by doing that.
Sounds good.
Does that make sense?
It makes sense to me. And I do believe that there's a power in that within LinkedIn, because you can really then target individuals with the titles that you're looking for that could be a great connection for you. And using that as a power is to search. And I know we've had a webinar on there, how to use LinkedIn as a marketing tool. So that's another one to link back to what we've been doing, is to utilize those contacts that you have and then go fishing within the contacts of the people that are contacting yours and who are their contacts, as it's kind of like the 8 degrees of separation. So that is a great piece. It does take a lot of work, but if you have your hook and you have your message, then you can go out there and send it and going after those, the marketing person or going after the person that you think may have it. So,
exactly.
You know,
well,
like
something to note on that as well is, you know, like to use your fishing example, because that's one that I use all the time. Like if we continue to use the same bait, we're going to continue to catch the same small bass, for example. Mm-hmm. But we have to use different bait, i.e. different hooks, in order to catch different types of fish, right? So not every hook is going to work on every potential customer. So we have to have other ways of attracting our dream customer through different hooks and things like that, because they all have different things that they desire. So really understanding that is a really fundamental foundational piece to pulling people into a sales process or something like that.
So I'm inquiring that, I'm not trying to use Connie, but I'm using her as an example. But if she were to go to LinkedIn and try to find doctors that are alternative medicine doctors or may have a piece where they have used CBD oil in their prescriptions or in their treatment plans for different things. Is there a way she finds those and then kind of can reach out to the doctors and maybe give them a hook for being able to be I don't want to say a client, but to recommend her product over what they may be using currently?
So something that I should have touched on in here too is using different levels of intent So intent would be like, how close is someone to the point of purchase? So in this scenario, what I would probably say is I would reach out to Dr. Joe Brown, for example, and I'd say, hey, Joe Brown, are you already offering CBD oil at your practice? Yes or no, right? So we've given them a very clear ability to respond with a very simple question. And we've been able to find out, like, are they already offering this, you know, as an alternative medicine sort of doctor, for example. So that was just something that came to mind, like, right away as you were asking that. But that's where you could show high intent, like, hey, if they are already offering it, then you could say, well, hey, like, I'd love to offer you, you know, send you a free sample, you know, of, you know, Nona oils, et cetera, et cetera. You know, so that's, you know, a way that you could make that connection there. Obviously, you'd want to work on that a little bit further, but that would be one way to do it.
Anybody else have any other questions? Let's see. Yesha had a jump off. She said, great information. You know, there's a lot you can do, and it's just trying to, I think the keys of this, what I've gotten out of it is to look for your target market, find what the pains are there that competitors aren't solving those problems. Yep. And if you find what pains them, or it may even be worth the call to ask them, is what are your pains for it? So if you're an IT company per se, is to call and say, are you having any issues with your current IT pieces, or calling up and just asking for some of those folks to find out the research so that you can start building your piece. So a lot of it is, it's kind of like, I guess even in cooking, you know, the majority of the work is in the prep. And if you can prep well and set yourself up, then the sale piece will come together and be able to do the actual pitches, is where I'm kind of summarizing kind of what you said and kind of putting my notes into what you were discussing there. So.
Yeah, for sure. It basically, it's what's called gap selling. Like, when you can sell the gap between your customer moving from point A to point B and use that in your marketing, they'll take action.
Very cool. Well, there's no other questions, that we can go ahead and end today. I know we went over, but Will's been very gracious of his time to be able to spend with us. So if anybody else has anything, please feel free to unmute for the next 30 seconds and ask your question. And we'll go from there.
Awesome. Thank you so much for the opportunity. I hope everyone really got a lot of information out of this, and would really hope and encourage you guys to follow that process and get it implemented into your marketing.
Yeah. Some good tips all the way through for no matter what your business is, but it is finding that and identifying that. And I think if you do your homework, it will help with solving the issues with what you're looking for and driving people to you instead of pushing out to them. So some good stuff. So Will, thank you very much for being here again.
You're welcome.
We really appreciate it. And thank everybody here for being on the call and sticking around a little bit longer to get some of the information that was put here. And we'd love to see you again. We've got a lot coming up, so appreciate everybody. And thank you so much. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, everyone.